Hi, everybody, and welcome to episode 3 of the Carpenters Q&A. I'm Chris May. And before we jump into the topic of discussion for today's video, I wanted to address a couple of more questions that came in from fellow fans, Carpenters fans. So the first question is there a studio version of Thank You for the Music with complete lead vocal? The answer is yes, there is. The Carpenters completed it, recorded it, and completed it in 1978. The reason that Richard never put it out, or that they never put it out initially, or in later years, is because Richard felt that that ABBA had the definitive version with it. And really, Richard's arrangement was styled a bit, you know, a lot of the ideas that he had sort of come up with really were just borrowed from the original ABBA recording. And so they didn't feel that they were really going to do any better than what ABBA had done originally. And so that's why it was never released. It is one that I think that if Richard were ever to put out another compilation album and include an unreleased track, that would be one that I would recommend. There are a couple of more that are kind of hanging around that I think that he would maybe consider putting out. One would be the original version of Close to You, the version that was cut prior to the definitive version that we all know. And that was where Karen was on drums, and it was sort of a Harry Nilsson-esque reading of it vocally. They finished it. They completed it. All the overdubbing was done. Herb Alpert didn't care for it. He thought that they had missed the mark with it, and so that's when he had recommended bringing in Hal Blaine, and of course, the rest, as we know, is history. And so, but that would be another unreleased track that I think fans would enjoy. And the third is one that actually has come up in recent discussion with Richard, and upon listening to it, he thought it actually sounds pretty good. And that is, What Are You Doing for Love? It was an outtake that was recorded on October 11th of 71 for the Tan album. On the master currently is bass, piano, drums, and Karen's work lead. The reason it was never finished for the Tan album is because it clocked in at just over 2 minutes. And as Richard has gone on record as saying, and we all know, that the Tan album ultimately, I think the whole album came in at about 30 minutes or 31 minutes or something, 29. I'm trying to remember what it was, but it's about a half hour. It was a short album. It was a great album. But to put another short song on there was not going to do them any justice at that point, as far as, yeah, they needed longer songs, and he just wasn't finding them, and they didn't have time to do anything else. So that's why that track never got included. So I hope that answers your question. Anyway, going back to Thank You for the Music, yes, there is a completed version with the lead vocal. Another question is, does Richard own many previously unreleased TV appearances? Does he own a copy of the Yellow Brick Road version of Those Good Old Dreams? Will they ever be released? Yes, he owns the original tapes. As far as the TV specials, if we're talking about the early NBC special, Make Your Own Kind of Music, and then the later ABC TV specials in the late 70s, yes, Richard owns those. Whether or not he's ever going to release any more or anything as far as video is concerned, I really don't know. There are two issues with it. One is, of course, his favorite special was Music, Music, Music. Karen wasn't vocally she was certainly sounding great, but physically she wasn't well, and so that has always been an issue. And also the fact that there are other copyright, there are other clearances that have to be secured with a number of those, because there were guest artists. And so that's part of the reason why a number of those recordings from those television specials, at least the on the video side, have never been put out. As far as the alternate, the Yellow Brick Road version of Those Good Old Dreams, Richard likely didn't release it initially because he didn't care for it. So I doubt that he's ever going to change his mind on that. But yes, those tapes are all down in the archive. All of the A&M tapes, as far as the films that we've seen, the music videos, Richard has possession of those, and he does own them. So I want to jump into the topic for today, which is really getting in depth on the Carpenters sound. And to do that, I'm going to use We've Only Just Begun. I did this at the Carpenters 50th anniversary celebration back in 2019. I was very fortunate to be asked to sit alongside and co-moderate that panel. In fact, one of the co-panelists, Earl Dummler, who you all may recognize his name, he provided oboe and English horn on a number of the Carpenter tracks, continues to do so to this day. He did some overdubs for the Royal Philharmonic. Earl, anyway, he's going to be joining us via Zoom. We're going to do a little Q&A, talk about his career on the whole, and also kind of move in a little bit on his... focus on his working with the Carpenters and his contributions there and some of the memories that he has of that. So keep an eye out for that in the coming weeks. But I wanted to use We've Only Just Begun as an example. And first off, I wanted to say that what's interesting about the Carpenters' sound is that, you know, obviously the first and foremost identifier is Karen's lead vocal. But the sound, as we know the Carpenters today, was so much more than that. It was also everything that Richard was contributing as a writer, an arranger, a producer, and a vocalist. Richard is not a lead vocalist per se, although he did contribute some leads, and I think he did a good job actually on a number of them. But his ability to blend vocally with Karen and create the sound that they did with the four and five part on upwards, as I said, to six, seven, eight parts, the harmony, it's remarkable, and many people have copied that, and not only tried to copy the technique that they employed, but also a lot of the chord diagrams, the structures that Richard would come up with to create that sound with Karen. I'm going to do a vocal demonstration taken from the master on We've Only Just Begun. It's the same demonstration, as I said, that I did back in 2019. Just real quick, so the what's interesting is that the evolution of the multi-tracking technology was happening as the Carpenters were evolving as artists. I mean, even pre-Carpenters, pre-A&M days. I mean, let's go back to some of the early demos that can be found on the box set From the Top in 1991 and then re-released as the Essential Collection in 1997. I believe the Essential Collection is still available. You can buy that. But those early demos that were recorded in the Carpenters' living room, first with the Richard Carpenter Trio and then later on with the their sextet known as Spectrum, they were, with the Trio, they were recorded in stereo on two tracks on Richard's Sony tape recorder. But for Spectrum, it was they would play the instrumental track down live. They could record independently or together on that machine, on Richard's on his Sony, and so they would record the instrumental down on track one, and then they would switch over to track two, and then they would add their vocals. Well, by 1966, 67, actually, they were recording at Joe Osborne's garage studio, and now they're on four tracks. And then they signed with A&M in 1969, now they're on eight tracks. And as I mentioned, a few of the four track recordings, the demos that were done at Joe's, were actually transferred over to the eight track machine and used for the for inclusion on the Offering album in 1969. By late 69, they began recording tracks for the Close to You album. Now A&M was up to 16 track recording. So this is all happening. I mean, if you think about it, this is all in the span of about 5 years. The Carpenters have gone from two track to four track, now then to eight track. By Close to You, now they're up to 16 track. So We've Only Just Begun, which was recorded for the Close to You album. First off, instrumentally, it consisted of piano, bass, drums, Wurlitzer electric piano. There's a horn section, which was five piece. It consisted of three trumpets, two trombones. And then you have a string section, which was a 16 piece, which included 10 violins, three violas, three celli. And then you have, of course, Doug Strawn's famous clarinet intro and reintro at the end. And then you have all of the, Karen, of course, sings the lead in the bridge. Her vocal is double tracked. And then in between verses one and two and on the bridge, you have as many as four parts singing the harmony with Richard. On the early Carpenter recordings, when I say early, from 1969 until late 73, early 74, anytime they overdubbed backing vocals, they not only double tracked every part, they actually triple tracked it. They figured out that they didn't need to do that by mid 74. So all of the Carpenter vocal harmonies went from being, you know, let's say it was a four part harmony, it went from being 12 voices to being eight voices. They would just double track those parts because it really didn't add that much more. And part of this was because they were so good at what they did that when they stacked their parts, they locked so tightly with themselves on their own part and then with each other in the harmonies, if that makes any sense, that you know, they really didn't go, the phasing, there was so much accuracy that to add another part really didn't add that much because, again, they were so locked in with what they had done on the previous overdubbing that they didn't need to do that. So we'll focus on, as I said, we've only just begun. So on the master, it was again, we're talking four parts, triple tracked, 12 voices. Karen was responsible for two of those parts, six of those voices. Richard was responsible for the other six voices, two parts. And the section of the tune, right at the top, at the end of verse one, you know, Karen sings, "We've only just begun to live, white lace and promises, a kiss for luck, and we're on our way. In comes the drum fill," and then you hear Richard at first, triple tracked with himself. Actually, I take that back. It's six Richard. So he's actually that first, "We've only begun," before it breaks into gun. That initial lead in by Richard is actually overdubbed six times. And then when they break into the chord, it's, as I said, it's 12 voices, triple tracked, four parts. So I'm going to demonstrate using the tracks from the master stripped down what this sounded like as they put it together. So you have the first run, which is the very first time that they're each singing it. Karen is singing the upper part of the outer part of the chord. Richard's down on the bottom. They're singing simultaneously. This is the first track, and this is what it sounded like raw.
"White lace and promises, a kiss for luck, and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
One thing I wanted to note is, before we go on to the double track, because I want to play that next, is Karen and Richard were very unique in the way that they stacked their voices on tape. Whether they were double tracking with themselves, so let's say Karen on a bridge or a hook, a chorus maybe, or on an entire lead vocal where her voice is actually double tracked throughout, or whenever they sang backing vocal harmonies. Normally an artist, when they go into the studio and they set out to record and then double track in unison with themselves. They sing the first take. Once they get it the way that they want it, they go back and they sing the second take. They sing with themselves and they listen to their first take. In other words, their first take is audible while they're adding the second take so that they can match the pitch. They can, the in and out points, you know, when they start the beginning of a word and then they end the, you know, at the end of the phrase, they come out of a word. It's all got to be very tight when you're talking about studio recording. Karen and Richard didn't do it that way. They would sing the entire part, listen back to it, get it, make sure that it was the way that they wanted it. And then Ray Gerhart, their engineer, would mute, per Karen and Richard's instruction, the previous take. And they would sing it again as if they're singing it for the first time. They were so precise with their pitch and their phrasing on these things that they almost always recorded either a lead vocal or backing vocal harmonies in that way. They would record the take and then move on. They'd re-record it again, just re-sing what they did the first time, but now on another track. And in the case of, as I mentioned, with these earlier recordings where they were triple tracking everything, they would do the same thing again. And when all of those faders were pushed up, it was so perfect that you would get this sound. And of course then you'd start adding the inner parts of the chord and now you get this, you know, it's quite astounding. They were the only group that I'm aware of that ever did that, and considering just how monumental the Carpenter sound has been to the history of pop music and just, you know, American music in general, to think that that's how they've done it all these years is remarkable. So getting back to the examples, so here is the same two parts, Karen on top, Richard on bottom. Now they're doubled with each other. This is what it sounds like, and you start to hear some of the phasing going on.
White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
Okay, now they're going to triple track it, and this is what it sounds like. Now it's going to sound a bit fatter.
White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
Okay, those were the two outer parts of the chord, triple track. This is what the two inner parts of the chord sound like, triple tracked, and then I'll play it all together so you can hear that big stack.
White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
So you hear the parts are just static. They don't really move. It's the two outer parts that move around as the chord changes. But that creates the close harmony. Now you take all four parts, 12 voices, put them together, and this is what you get.
White lace and promises, a kiss for luck and we're on our way.
We've only begun.
And that is the classic Carpenter sound that we've all come to know and love. I hope you guys found the video informative, and I look forward to seeing you next time.